الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إقرارا بربوبيته وإرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر. كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وقائدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله أرسله الله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون ولو كره المشركون. بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين، فصلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. أما بعد عباد الله، فإني أوصيكم ونفسي المخطئة بتقوى الله، وأحثكم على طاعته، وأحذركم وبال عصيانه ومخالفة أمره، فمن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يرى ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة شرا يرى. يقول ربكم سبحانه: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد، all praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and peace be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah Almighty, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. And I encourage you to fear no one but Allah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Holy Quran: all those who believe, fear Allah. Fear Allah the way he should be feared, and do not die unless you're on the state of Islam. My brothers in Islam, today is the 17th of Ramadan, the 17th day of this blessed month, the month of Ramadan, this beautiful month that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had gifted this ummah. And what a great gift, and what a great blessings, and what a great grace from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us to be this nation that Allah chose for Ramadan, and Allah chose Ramadan for. And my brothers in Islam, the month of Ramadan not only brings upon us memories of great worships and great piety and righteousness, but the month of Ramadan also brings upon us great memories of great battles and great conquests and great moments that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed his victory and support to the believers. The month of Ramadan is known of the month of victories and the month of conquests that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the ummah, this ummah, the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with great victories and great openings and great conquests. And on the 17th of Ramadan, a day like this day, 1,432 years ago. 1,432 years ago, where it was the second year of the Hijra, during the month of Ramadan, on the 17th of Ramadan that we are at right now, the 17th of Ramadan, it was the great battle, the battle of Badr. That great battle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also describes as the battle of the Furqan, the distinguisher, the distinguished between the haq, the truth, and the batil, the falsehood. It was on the 17th of Ramadan. And here we are today on the 17th of Ramadan. And what a day and a moment to remember this great moment and that great battle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to the believers over their enemies, the disbelievers. And the great battle of Badr is known to the scholars as the first major battle that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had participated in. And it all begins when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam receives the news that Abu Sufyan is leading a great caravan of hundreds of camels being carried with many stocks and money from the people of Quraysh, that Abu Sufyan is arriving back with great profit from Syria to the people of Quraysh. And when the news arrives, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decides to intercept this caravan and attack this caravan and take what this caravan had carried to avenge for his people and compensate his people, in particular what the people of Quraysh had done to the believers in Mecca. They've taken their own wealth, taken their own homes, taken their own lands, and they even killed some of them. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has the rights to retaliate and avenge for his people and compensate himself by attacking the caravan of those who attacked him before. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam marches out of Medina with a small number of companions. 313. 313 believers. 313 companions marched with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Medina. All came out with the intention to attack a caravan that the people of that caravan do not exceed 50 of them. None of them came out with the intention of war. None of them came out with the intention of fighting. So they all came out with little weapons. The maximum one of them had was one sword and one shield. 313. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam encourages the Sahaba to accompany him to attack the caravan of Abu Sufyan. And he did not insist on anyone, nor that he commanded anyone to come out, nor that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam spoke anything against those who did not come out with him. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with the 313 companion and soldier, 313 companions and soldiers, the maximum one of them had was a shield and one sword. 313 with only two horses. 313 with only 70 camels. They did not have the intention to fight. They are going to attack the caravan of Abu Sufyan, and who they're going to fight? 40, 50, 60 men? There's 313 of us. But Abu Sufyan was smart. And Abu Sufyan, heard the intentions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and his marching of Medina, Sir Abu Sufyan managed to escape from where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam had planned to meet him. And at the same time, Abu Sufyan, and that's before Abu Sufyan was a Muslim, sent one of his men to the people of Quraysh, calling upon the people of Quraysh, saying to them that Muhammad had came out with 313 soldiers to attack your wolf and your caravan. So prepare an army and come out to attack Muhammad. So Abu Jahl, la'anahullah, with all this hostility and enmity towards Islam and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he prepared an army of 1,300 soldiers. And then Abu Sufyan managed to escape. So he sent the news to Abu Jahl, informing him that there's no need for you to come out of Mecca and march out of Mecca with that number of soldiers. Your caravans, your wealth, your stock, your money, your valuables are now secured. So go back to Mecca. But Abu Jahl insisted that he wants to fight Muhammad. Abu Jahl insisted that he'll meet with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam's army at Badr and fight them and crush the army of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not knowing that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has the Lord of the universe supporting him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the news comes to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that Abu Sufyan managed to escape, and now Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is between the choice of going back to Medina without anything, as he promised his people that he'll attack the caravan of the people of Quraysh and compensate them of their loss that they lost in Mecca, or stand in front of an army that the number of this army exceeds the number of his army 3 to 4 times. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was put in an embarrassing situation in front of his Sahaba. So he gathered them and he stood in front of them and addressed them and he said, I promised you that we'll come out and attack the caravan of Abu Sufyan and compensate ourselves from the loss that we had lost in Mecca and come out and come back with spoils and booty to Medina. But unfortunately, as you all heard, Abu Sufyan managed to escape and go the other route and other way to go to Mecca. And now the people of Quraysh had came out with 1,300 of their men to face you and fight you. So what's your opinion? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not prepared. The army of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is not prepared. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had 313 soldiers, while the disbelievers had 1,300. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam had 2 horses in his entire camp, while the disbelievers had over 200 horses. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam had 70 camels for 313, while the disbelievers of Quraysh had over 1,000 camels. Where's the balance here? Where is the balance here? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is standing in front of his Sahaba, addressing them, saying to them, I promised you one thing, but now it's war. And it's war with people, their number is 3 to 4 times our number, and they're a lot more prepared than us. So what do you say? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was the first companion to stand up and show his support to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam by saying to the Messenger of Allah, oh Messenger of Allah, go, we are behind you. Then it was Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu to get up and show his support to the Messenger of Allah and say to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, oh Muhammad, go, we are behind you. And then it was al-Miqdad ibn al-Aswad radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He gets up and he says, oh Messenger of Allah, O Messenger of Allah, do you think we will say to you what the people of Israel and the children of Israel said to Musa when Musa commanded them to enter Jerusalem or the sacred land go you and your Lord fight, we are sitting over here. O Messenger of Allah, by Allah, we will say to you, O Messenger of Allah, go, we are coming with you. We're not going to say to you what the people of Israel said, go you and your Lord fight, we are sitting here. We're going to say to you, go you and your Lord fight, we are coming with you. But this, three leaders and three men, Abu Bakr, Umar, Al-Miqdad, we're from the Muhajirin, from the migrants. And the majority of people with the Prophet alayhi salatu was salam, and out of those 313 soldiers with him, the majority of them are from the Ansar, are from the Medina. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to hear their stance. He wanted to hear what they think. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his wisdom, he looks towards them and then he says to them, tell me what you think, O people. Tell me. Suggest to me, O people. So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, the leader and the chief of the people of Ansar, the one that when he died, the Messenger of Allah said, this is a man that the throne of Allah shook because of his death. He gets up and he says, O Messenger of Allah, are you referring to us, the Ansar? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, indeed. What's your opinion? What's your stance? So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, he says, O Messenger of Allah, Allah sent you to us with the truth, and we followed you. You commanded us, we obeyed. You forbidded us, we abstained. O Messenger of Allah, O Messenger of Allah, we had given you our oath and our pledges that will stand by you no matter what the situation is. And by Allah, if you go through the oceans, we will be behind you. Today is the day that Allah Azza wa Jal wants to show you that we are real men and we stick by our words. By Allah, we are very patient when it comes to fighting and very firm when it comes to the walls. Radiallahu ta'ala an. Very strong, very firm. They did not argue with the Messenger of Allah. You said this to us, look what happened now. Look at the situation you put us in. Look at this, look at that. But there were men, strong, firm men, who stood firm by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and did not hesitate to please Allah and his Messenger. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam sees this great enthusiasm and momentum from the companions. So he relies on his Lord and marches towards Badr to meet with the people of Quraysh. 313, two horses. 313, 70 camels. That each camel will have three companions riding on it, including the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was sharing one camel with two other companions. One of them is Ali, and the other one is Uthama. So Ali and Uthama will look at one another. How can we share one camel with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Let him ride and we walk. So they said, O Messenger of Allah, how about you ride the camel and we walk? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said to them, you are not stronger than me for me not to walk, nor that you are better than me for me not to get the rewards from Allah Azza wa Jal. Humbleness, humility for the sake of Allah and for the sake of the believers. Until the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam arrives to Badr, 150 kilometers from Medina, halfway through to Mecca, where the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam will camp there with the believers, waiting for the arrival of the disbelievers. 1,300 of them, when the news arrived to them that Abu Sufyan had secured the caravan, 300 of them retreated and went back to Mecca. Abu Jahl is left with 1,000. Still, 1,000 from 313, That's triple the number of the believers. Until that moment came where the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is addressing his companions, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reminding the believers what Allah azza wa jalla had promised them: either victory in the battle of Badr, or paradise to those who die in this battlefield. There is no loss. The believers will never lose if they are with Allah, because when they are with Allah, Allah is with them. And how could Allah lose in an army? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. How could an army lose when Allah Azza wa Jal is with them? How could an army lose when it's assisted by Allah? How could an army lose when it's supported by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Either one of two: victory or martyrdom. Victory from Allah or paradise to those who die on the battlefield. And now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam lines up this minority army, 313, not even prepared to fight, with very minimal weapons and shields, two horses. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam starts to divide his camps and divides the soldiers into platoons. The platoon of the Ansar, led by Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, and the platoon of the Muhajirin, led by Ali ibn Abi Talib. On the right wing, Az-Zubayr ibn Awam with his horse. On the left wing, Al-Miqdad ibn Aswad with his horse. And the general banner was in the hands of Mus'ab ibn Umair, and the leadership was in the hands of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam will be built for him a tent to be his headquarters. And there the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that night, the night of the 17th of Ramadan, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, while all the companions are sleeping, and Allah Azza wa Jalla says, and we sent upon them to sleep comfortably that night. It was a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jalla upon them. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was awake. Awake with who? Awake with his Lord Allah Almighty, asking Allah Azza wa Jalla to give this minority soldiers victory over their enemies that entire night. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is supplicating and praying to Allah, asking Allah to give him victory over his enemies. Until that moment where the people of Quraysh had arrived, he stood in front of the camp of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and from far away the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam can see them standing. And Allah Azza wa Jal makes their numbers little in the eyes of the Sahaba, so they do not lose motivation. Allah makes the numbers of the disbelievers, the people of Quraysh, small in the eyes of the people of Muhammad, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, so they don't lose motivation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the numbers of the Sahaba small in the eyes of the disbelievers, so they could have more motivation to fight them. Allah wants it to happen. Allah Azza wa Jal wants this battle to happen, so I could prove to everyone that when the haq comes, there is no room for the batil. When the haq comes, the haq prevails the batil. When Muhammad is there and the soldiers who follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the victory is always with them. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam encourages his companions to be firm and to remind them that whoever fights for the sake of Allah firm and strong on this day, Allah will give him the paradise. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam lines up his camps, his soldiers. And amongst those who was out of line was Suwad ibn Ghuzayya radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was out of line. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with something in his hand, he pushes him into line. So this companion, he says, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, you harmed me. You hurt me. And I want to retaliate from you." Isn't that what Islam is about? You hit him, you've got the right to hit him back. I want to retaliate. You harmed me, I want to retaliate. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uncovers his stomach. And Sawad grabs the stomach of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam and kisses it. So the Messenger of Allah looks at him and says, "Oh Sawad, what made you do this now?" He said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, as you could see, this could be the last encounter. And last time I see your beautiful face. So I wanted the last thing, part of my life, is that my body touches your body." Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. These are the hearts of men, believers, strong, firm believers, who feed no one except Allah and wanted the pleasure of no one except Allah and His Messenger. And then the people of Quraysh will come forward and ask the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to send out three of his main strong men to fight against three of their main men. Who are the three main men from the people of Quraysh? Utbah, Shaybah, and his son Al-Walid. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam sends out three people from the Ansar, from the Medina. So Utbah, Shaybah, and Walid look at them and say, "Who are you?" They say, "We are from Medina." So they say to them, "You are generous, noble people. We don't want to fight you. We want people from our own blood, from our own kind. We want people from the people of Mecca who migrated to you." So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he calls upon and he says, "Oh Hamza, oh Ali, oh Ubaidah, get up for the paradise. The width of that paradise as wide as the heavens and the earth. Get up! Get up and fight these people." So they get up. Hamza, Ali, and Ubaidah. Three of them from the family of the Prophet. Three of them from the direct family of the Prophet to fight against three strong, powerful warriors from the people of Quraysh. Hamza kills his opponent. Ali kills his opponent. Ubaidah, he injures his opponent, and his opponent injures him, until Hamza and Ali attacked the opponent of Ubaidah, and three of them killed the disbelievers. Brought the morale of the believers high. Took the morale of the disbelievers down. And now, 330 to fight against 1,000. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is watching. He raises his hands. "Oh Allah! Oh Allah, the victory that you had promised me. Oh Allah, the victory that you had promised me. Oh Allah, if you destroy these believers, if you destroy these believers today, you will be not worshipped on the surface of this earth ever again. They are the only believers who exist on the surface of this earth. Oh Allah, the victory that you had promised me." And Abu Bakr, his deputy, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, behind him, hearing the dua of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, so he calms him down and he says to him, "Oh Messenger of Allah, you've insisted on your Lord so much." And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is calling upon his Lord and Master, "Oh Allah, the victory that you had promised me." Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam comes out of his tent, looks in the heavens, and he says, "Allahu Akbar." Jibreel with 3,000 angels descending down to support the believers. The victory of Allah. The victory of Allah. The victory of Allah is always with those who give victory back to Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfills His promise, where Allah azza wa jal will give victory to those minority, 313, against the majority, 1,000 of disbelievers. 70 from amongst the disbelievers were killed, and 70 were captives, and only 14 from amongst the Muslims were killed. The victory of Allah. And amongst those who were killed in that battle, the heads and the chiefs of the people of Quraysh. Abu Jahl, Umayyah, Utbah, Shaybah, Al-Walid. Those who used to make mockery of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Those who used to fight the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Before the battle, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam told them, by Allah, I could see Abu Jahl dead over here. And I could see Umayyah dead over here. And I could see Shaybah dead over there. And exactly where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam pointed, they will die. They were all dead over there. Allah is great. Allah is great. And Islam is great. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had always promised victory to Islam. But it's about where the Muslims are. The battle of Badr, the battle of the Furqan, the distinguisher between the haq and the truth. The battle that Allah Azza wa Jal fulfilled His promise to the companions. It is a great battle for us to remember. In a day like this day, exactly 1,432 years ago, on the 17th of Ramadan, this great battle took place. But it's not about us entertaining ourselves to hear about this great battle and say, wallahi, that was a nice battle. But for us to reflect and ponder and know that the promise of Allah continues to the day of judgment, that when you support the deen of Allah, Allah will support you. When you are firm with Allah, Allah will be with you. When you stand for Islam, Allah will stand by you. Victory to the believers was never, ever, ever granted to them because of their large numbers. Not because of their artillery or weaponry. Not because of their influence or knowledge. Victory was always granted to them when they were with Allah Azza wa Jal. When they were firm believers. When they were strong believers. Who feared no one but Allah. Like this Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. They stood firm in front of their enemies. Even though their enemies are three times more than them. But they had no fear except from Allah. And they relied on no one except Allah. And because of that, Allah gave them victory. But that moment we disobey Allah, and that moment that we are distant away from Allah, is that moment that we never ever see victory from Allah Azza wa Jal. We need to know. We need to understand. We need to comprehend that our victory, our honor, our dignity, our respect is through Islam and nothing but Islam. And that moment that we abandon Islam is that moment Allah humiliates us. The battle of Badr, my brothers in Islam, is a great battle for us to remember on the 17th of Ramadan, the second year of the Hijrah, 1,432 years ago, is the battle of the Furqan that Allah Azza wa Jal mentions clearly in the Quran Kareem. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين. Please come forward and let your brothers at Tabak, inshallah, have room. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر أشكره وهو الذي وعد المزيد لمن شكر وأصلي وأسلم وبارك على النبي المعتبر وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا محمدا عبده ورسوله. My brothers in Islam, when this ummah and the members of this ummah are connected to Allah, Allah once again will be connected to them. When our hearts are with Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will be with us. When the believers used to go out on any expedition or battle, even that their enemies will exceed their numbers 10 times, they had no fear from the number of their enemies. But the only fear they had is when they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only fear they had is when they are far away from Allah Azza wa Jal. But when they are with Allah, obeying Allah, worshipping Allah, they have no other choice except that they win these battles or enter the paradise as martyrs. No other choice. This is the believer. This is the mu'min. And this is the iman that we lack in our lives. We are so distant away from Allah, and we want Allah Azza wa Jalla to give us victory. We disobey Allah, and we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to honor us. May Allah have mercy on Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. During his khilafah, when 36,000 Muslims stood against 300,000 Persians with the leadership of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Umar ibn al-Khattab sends a letter to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and please pay attention to those words, where Umar ibn al-Khattab says to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, the only reason that Allah gives us victory over our enemies is because our enemies disobey Allah. The only reason that Allah Azza wa Jal gives us victory over our enemies, even though our enemies' numbers exceed our numbers 10 times. But the only reason Allah Azza wa Jal gives us victory over our enemies is because our enemies disobey Allah. So if we disobey Allah the way our enemies disobey Allah, then there is no reason for Allah to give us victory. If we disobey Allah the way our enemies disobey Allah, then why would Allah give us victory? Why would Allah support us? When we Muslims disobey Allah Azza wa Jal, like how the disbelievers disobey Allah. When we Muslims turn away from Allah the way the disbelievers turn away from Allah. When we Muslims abandon Islam the way the disbelievers abandon Islam, why would Allah support us? Why would Allah Azza wa Jal give us victory? My brothers in Islam, we need to turn back to Allah with our hearts and minds and limbs and actions back to Allah Azza wa Jal. And that moment we turn back to Allah is that moment Allah will turn back to us. I ask Allah Azza wa Jal at this moment, at this place, to support all the Muslims around the world. Oh Allah, we ask you that you support every single Muslim around the world the way you supported the Sahaba during the day of Badr. Oh Allah, support our brothers and sisters in Syria. Oh Allah, support our brothers and sisters in Palestine. Oh Allah, support our brothers and sisters in Egypt. Today is a very, very terrifying day in Egypt. Don't forget them in your dua. And don't forget every single Muslim in your dua. عباد الله اتقوا الله فيما أمر وانتهوا عما عنه نهى وزجر وحافظوا على حضور الجمع والجماعات واعلموا أن الله أمر بأمر عظيم عميم بدأ به بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه فقال عز من قائل إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت وسلمت وباركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وارض اللهم عن الصحابة الكرام وعن التابعين وتابعيهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه لكل خير ومن أراد بهم غير ذلك فخذه أخذ عزيز مقتدر لا تبقي منهم ولا تذر اللهم انصر إخواننا في سوريا اللهم انصر إخواننا في فلسطين اللهم انصر إخواننا في مصر اللهم كن معهم ولا تكن عليهم اللهم انصرهم على طاغيتهم وعلى أعدائهم يا أرحم الراحمين فإنهم لا يعجزونك يا رب العالمين اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك يا ربنا قريب مجيب للدعوات اللهم اتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار يا مقلب القلوب والأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا مصرف القلوب والأبصار ثبت قلوبنا إلى طاعتك، وفقنا لما تحبه وترضاه، استخدمنا لدينك ورفع راية نبيك. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى، نسألك من خير ما سألك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. أنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. قوموا لصلاتكم يرحمكم الله.